Good morning. We are ready to start. I have 8:01, so I'm already a minute late. But good morning, everybody, and welcome to Continuing Professional Education Services Hot Topics, opportunity to get some information out to licensed individuals, community members, anybody who is interested in learning. And today's hot topic is a good one. Well, they're all good. And, Monitored Natural Attenuation guidance document and all the ins and the outs. And I want to make sure we get that out to you. This is recorded because we want to make sure that we give the opportunity for people who were not able to attend to be able to watch the video later on at their leisure. And that goes up on our website. I did put the link to our website, which is seepsnj.com. I'm Phil Brilliant. I am the CFO of Seeps. As well as sometimes during my day I'm with Brilliant Environmental Services. And along with me today is Julian Masago, who is the executive director of Seeps, as well as Dr. Jorge Berkowitz, who is the CEO of the board, the chairman of the board. We'll be doing this presentation today. Before I give a real formal introduction that could take 20 to 30 minutes in itself of Dr. Berkowitz, I just want to give you some of the ground rules for today. This is a meeting format. So everybody has the opportunity to turn their camera on and to ask questions. We ask that you kind of raise your hand. We'll call on you. That way we can keep some control in the room. Also, you can put your questions into the chat and I'll make sure that they're asked of George and we'll go back and forth. I did put, and I'll do it one more time, into the chat. Those are the slides, copy of the slide deck for today to make sure that everybody gets an opportunity to have those with them. And also, we have some additional courses for credit this week and next. Tomorrow is a two-part course on the requirements for childcare and educational facilities, both the guidance and the rules for those who do or are interested, LSRPs, as well as other professionals. That is tomorrow and next Tuesday, the 29th. You can sign up on our website. And also on Wednesday, we have a great course in investigating groundwater, contaminated groundwater impacts to surface water, good technical class. That is on Wednesday morning. All of those classes are webinar formats. And later this month, if you are a UST certified contractor, we'll be back in person at the Eco Complex for those who need credits so you can renew, or if you want to sit and take the exam for a UST certified contractor. So with that, I am going to jump in to today's presentation with Dr. Berkowitz. If you don't know him and love him, then you've missed a lot in the past 40 years in New Jersey environmental consulting, from his days at Rutgers University as a professor to his days at DEP up to the role of assistant commissioner, and probably for the better part of the past 35 years as a consultant at different firms, as now is on his own as he decides what to do with the LSRP license every 3 years. But he has continued to be an active participant in consulting and a great wealth of knowledge. So I will turn this over to Dr. Berkowitz for the presentation today.
Thank you, Phil. That goes a little ways in trying to heal what happened Saturday's dilemma. Thank you very much for the introduction, and I will tell if you needed to work with somebody as a partner, Phil's a good is probably the best selection you can make. Phil, thanks. It's always a good working with you. We got an hour to spend together. There is no way that you're going to become a guru about how to deal monitoring natural how to deal with monitoring natural. Let me try this again. Monitoring natural attenuation, MNA. It is a very complex task, maybe second only to technical impracticability. They are too high bars to get DEP to buy into. Because why? Because you're leaving contamination behind, in many cases greater than a cleanup level. In most cases greater than a cleanup level. That's why you need technical impracticability, for example. So the Monitoring Natural Attenuation Guidance document is one of the best documents you could have at your bedside. It is very well done. kudos to the department, particularly the appendices. When you take a look at the guidance document itself, you can't see that. When you take a look at the guidance document itself, you will find that the guidance, the narrative is around, let's see, about 50 some pages, 53 pages, 54 pages, something like that. But, and some of it highly technical, but when you take a look at the appendices, some of the most important appendices, if you wanted a primer to deal with a comprehensive examination of all the scientific stuff that you got to deal with, this is a good place to start. And your role as an LSRP is just that. You're not, you know, you've got to be a professional who keeps attuned with changes in technology and regulation and guidance. It's totally up to you. That's why you need 36 credits of continuing education. It's a profession. And it doesn't stop. It doesn't ever stop. It's a continuum because things are constantly changing. This guidance document was updated version 2, and it's much better than 1.0. Much better than 1.0, particularly as a resource. So if you add the appendices into the mix, you're looking at about 200 pages of guidance. And as such, there is a great opportunity for you to better understand biodegradation, statistical evaluation, spatial relationships. How do you prove it? It's all in here. Now, is it in there to the nth degree? No. But boy, it's a good primer. So let's get started. Leaving contamination behind, DEP doesn't generally like that, particularly when it exceeds a standard. But you can do it, particularly with TI, technical and practicability, or monitored natural attenuation. It's not for the faint of heart. Don't pretend that you can do it. If you take a look at the science that's involved, and get your team together and get your bench together and make it a strong bench and make sure your client knows that this is not going to be an easy path. You're going to have probably a series of technical consultations. We just got done. I was working with I'll mention her name, the Sadat Associates, which I used to work for Sadat Associates, but I was working with them on an expert case. No, that's wrong. We're trying to get a county a declaration of monitoring natural attenuation with a landfill. I would estimate that probably costs the county $20,000. Over a period of 2 years, it was a struggle. It was a struggle. And again, the technical consultation, it should be done in sequence. You should never start with a technical consultation after you've decided what to do and then go to the department. You should go to the department, particularly for things like monitored natural attenuation, technical and practicability, other far-reaching resolutions for your problem, and tell them what you're going to do in advance and get an early read. And like I say, it's almost like scheduling a bringing difficult news to a client is very similar to bringing difficult news to the department. But most importantly, and same with the client, can overrule you. DEP can overrule you. And I've been accused of DEP bashing. If that were the case, I'd be bashing myself because I was there for 8 years. Loved working with the department. But I will tell you right now that DEP is losing a lot of people who have the experience and the technical expertise. And Barry Frasco would be the perfect example, who's head of the scientific unit there. You lose somebody like that, and it doesn't work to your advantage at all. In many cases, particularly in the case that we worked with for the county recently, they didn't understand what we were trying to do with isotopic analysis, for example. And it's right in the guidance, by the way. Isotopic analysis is right in the guidance. Powerful tool, expensive tool. But again, I don't want to be accused of, I'm going to be observational. I'm not going to be judgmental. Observation. There are not a lot of people there who have LSRP licenses. In fact, I can't think of one. Yet they're evaluating your work. You professional engineering, engineers in the group, who has the ability to evaluate and review your work? Another professional engineer. So the question then becomes, do DEP reviewers need an LSRP license? And the answer is clearly no. But on the other hand, that creates a situation which could have negative consequences relative to their expertise. And you're getting real, and don't get me wrong, there's some really good young people there, no doubt about it, who want to do the best job that they can and will do as long as they're able. But they have the ability to put a team together, just like you have the ability to put a team together. And let me say this, if you're going to go it alone, with the sole purveyor of technical expertise in a very complex case, good luck. I once did an evaluation of the disciplines, the types of scientific disciplines or subjects that we're responsible for. I stopped at 14. And it means you need a bench, particularly if it's a complex monitored natural attenuation issue. You need somebody who's maybe a microbiologist, maybe a geophysicist, maybe a hydrogeologist, and maybe a risk assessor, quite frankly, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Somebody's good at statistics. And when you put all those talents together, all those disciplines together, it's very difficult. It's if not impossible to find one person who's totally in control of their fate when it comes to a multidisciplinary problem. So let's get started. That's my rant. We're going to spend the next part of 45 minutes or so together. I'm going to walk you through the guidance document to a certain degree. Again, you're not going to come out of here with the ability to know what isotopic analysis is, what microbiological degradation, what's ORP, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. How do you do mass flux? All that stuff. It's all in here. And most of us don't have the skills to begin with to do it, including me. I'll be perfectly honest with you. So I just want to go through this almost to whet your appetite, if you will, and to say, hey, I know this, but I don't know that. And maybe I can learn a lot about that. Maybe I can't. So the next time that I go to monitoring natural attenuation, I want to know what this document is demanding of me. And I want to know that if I have holes and chinks in the armor, how do I strengthen those? And it's not AI. Artificial intelligence can rue the day for us. And why do I mean that? When you bring somebody else on, what do you have to do in order to say, I'm going to rely upon this person because their expertise is greater than mine in this area? What do you have to do in order to make that a justifiable decision and put that member on the team? You have to evaluate their education, their experience, and training. And that's what the law says. How do you do that with AI? And I don't know. I don't have the answer to that. But we have seen demonstrations where we've used AI, somebody's used AI and says, do this, and out comes something. And it looks like it's good until you start looking at their outputs and say, well, how'd they come up with that? Who did that? Who's responsible for that decision? So let's get into it. Phil, next slide.
Yeah, just one comment. I don't want to feed your rant, but yeah. I would say that anybody who's working at DEP is not gaining the experience to be able to sit for the LSRP exam. So as in the old days where people would leave DEP and go to consulting firms, it's going to be much more difficult for them to do that. And we'll see what the future brings as far as even just employees and consulting firms.
Yeah. Well, I will tell you, Look, there's been a major exodus of expertise from the department. We've lost some really good people. However, we've got some really good people who have replaced them. And Gwen Zervis is my prime example, who is willing to listen and willing to evaluate. I used to have a chart that shows, okay, when a new person comes in, their willingness to change is logarithmic. It goes way up. And then when they own the program, it plateaus and then it comes back down. And the opportunity to really create and look into your program starts with a person who's new. That's an advantage, quite frankly, if they're willing to take it and willing to be able to take it by their supervisors. So at any rate, let's get going here. Okay, let's take a look at the meaning of the words monitored. Monitored simply means watching with time. Watching with time means sampling in most cases. You're gonna take a look at what's going on. Is it decreasing? I'm getting to all this. And we'll take a look at what it takes to really monitor the situation at a particular site to figure out if you have the reason to go with monitoring natural attenuation. Now, a lot of what we say you're going to think is totally applicable only to groundwater. Not so much. Organics, maybe, but not necessarily. What about organics in soil that don't get into groundwater, but yet exceed a soil standard, and so forth and so on? What about radionuclides? What about the metals? It's a whole different ballgame when you're dealing with metals than versus dealing with organics, inorganics versus organics. So natural means occurs without human intervention. That doesn't mean you don't do anything. In fact, monitoring natural attenuation should only come after you've tried to clean up the site actively. And you get to the point, you say, that's it. I can't get it down any further. I got 8 quarters of data that shows it's steady state. 8 quarters of data that shows it's decreasing, but not quarters of data that shows it's increasing. attenuation means contamination is not spreading. It's under control. The concentrations and mass are decreasing. And most importantly, based on your land use, and remember that phrase, based on your current land use, receptors are not likely to be affected. And your current land use may dictate who your receptors are. If there's a change from a vacant area of 24 acres and it's developed for residential purposes, it's a whole different ballgame. So you've got to understand land use and what the receptors are and who's potentially impacted, because that's the most important thing. Even in TI, in technical impracticability, the first rule of thumb is nobody can be impacted negatively by the material that you're leaving behind. Next, please, Phil. Okay, a couple factors. This is not technical impracticability. It's not in technical impracticability. That's a whole different game. That's a whole different game. And it's quite frankly, it's more laden than natural attenuation with what you have to do on the long term, including look for new technology every 5 years is a requirement for TI. That doesn't exist here at all. So not only can you get an REO, but in many cases, you get an REO with monitoring natural attenuation. It's a notice. So the first thing you do is you need a wrap in order to go for monitoring natural attenuation. And in that wrap, you are going to demonstrate how you're going to monitor over the long-term period for the fact that it's not changing its nature, it's not imperiling an ecological sensitive receptor or a human health receptor. It's also subject to biannual certification. So again, you got to go back and look and see if it's working. Just put it on the shelf and forget about it. Doesn't happen. And it requires a whole series of various notifications to the municipalities, to the counties, so forth and so on. It's also subject to annual remediation fees, and it's also subject to financial assurance. And are LSRPs required, and are there forms to be filed? Absolutely. Next, please, Phil. Okay. I want to spend some time with this, and you're going to hear me say again and again and again, the appendices. There's 98 pages of appendices. Forget the 53 pages of the narrative. These appendices are extremely well written. Kudos to the group that worked on it. I will tell you, the bench of the non-LSRP, I'm sorry, DEP folks was very strong. Extremely strong, and it shows. So the appendices are degradation and stabilization processes. In many cases, that's microbiological, and we'll talk about that a little bit later on. Compound-specific isotopic analysis. We used this recently, and I'll come back to it. Contamination mass calculation. And these are all formulaic. That's all formulaic and shows you how to do it and so forth and so on. The aquifer characteristics, evaluation of the aquifer characteristics. What are you looking for? Trend analysis and the statistical tests that are most pertinent and best used. References, the references are replete. In many cases, they actually use documents from the Wisconsin. I know they use documents from Wisconsin and I think some from California and include it in the appendices. And the glossary and the acronyms. The isotopic analysis. I'll talk about it later. I'll talk about it later. Next, please, Phil. By the way, that's 151 pages. Sum up the 53 pages and the 98 pages, you get out somewhere around 151 pages of information in the guidance document. Next, please, Phil. Okay, you got it. Okay, again, I'm going to say it over and over and over. Sensitive receptors must be protected and periodically evaluated. And sometimes those sensitive receptors change with time. We just talked about that, particularly residential development. This is required to be an effort and part of a wrap. You don't get monitored natural attenuation without a wrap. Let's be honest. And subject to the biennial certs, the wrap must identify your long-term monitoring strategy, which may be required based on the information to be changed, based on the information that you accrue with time. Do you get to a point that says, I'm ready to take a look at those 8 quarters? And they can be used in an unrestricted area as an RAO. A limited restricted RAO, let's say an unrestricted. Let's say groundwater was the only problem. You reach the asymptote and you're done. And basically, you can say that's unrestricted because of your monitored natural attenuation. You can use it in limited restriction with a deed notice. Or obviously, you can be part of an overall complex site that has a portion of it that you're going to use monitored natural attenuation if it's a large site and very complex with a lot of AOCs. Next, please. So here are some very salient points. And here's a third time I'm going to say it. No receptors impacted or likely to be impacted. And that's somewhat subjective. And that's one that DEP will throw at you because they can and they probably should. All sources of groundwater contamination have been identified. If you have an unidentified source, you're not going to get monitored natural attenuation. If you have a source, you have contaminant coming, it's not coming from from the areas of your AOCs that you know about, but it's coming from somewhere, maybe offsite, maybe not offsite. Maybe there's an AOC that you haven't identified, you're not ready. Installation of the Sentinel well network. This is really important. You have got to justify where you put those monitoring wells for the Sentinel well. And then you got to make sure that all of a sudden, let us say you have a situation, and let us say that there's a pipeline that you're going through. You put your Sentinel wells on the other side of the pipeline, and all of a sudden, it's perfectly clear. But the actual contamination groundwater is being intercepted by that pipeline. So that's not being monitored. So that's just a that happens, by the way. Or you have an occlude that stands in the way of your monitoring well. It's got the monitor. The sentinel wells have got to be well placed and justified, and you should revisit it periodically. So now the concentrations are decreasing or are asymptotic, and it's not a one order of magnitude. Your contamination that you've established with your asymptote is less than one order of magnitude greater than the cleanup standard. It's above the cleanup standard. Let's say the cleanup standard is 10, but it's less than 100. That is permissible as long as you've reached the asymptote. So you can apply for non-decreasing concentrations if all the above has been accomplished with 8 quarters of sampling, and the remaining concentration, I just said that, is less than one order of magnitude above the standard. And this requires long-term monitoring to make sure that what you based off your monitoring natural attenuation program on still is germane. Again, all this has to be in the wrap. Your long-term monitoring program. Again, where are we in the whole process here? We got an REO, or we got a wrap, which led to an REO with monitoring natural attenuation. Okay, but the two things that I said, you've got to have an RAO, you have to have a wrap, and you have to have an REO. And all the requirements attendant to having a REO with a wrap, the wrap needs to be very definitive on a long-term basis as what you're going to do, how you're going to do it. And has to be almost a separate insert into the application for a wrap. Next, please. Lines, section six is probably the most important section. Section six, I think, is around, oh, okay, it's 22 pages of the 53. Section six is lines of evidence. It is extremely technical, and it identifies the methods that you can use that are applicable to getting an MNA determination. And they are highly technical. Next, please, Phil. So they're divided up into three areas: the primary lines of evidence, secondary lines of evidence. I've been accused of not knowing how to spell based on my slides, and they're probably right. Secondary lines of evidence, tertiary lines of evidence, and let's go to the next one before I get too embarrassed by this. Primary lines of evidence, plume behavior. We want to take a look at the spatial aspects of the plume. First of all, where is it located? How far is, what's the extent of it? You've defined the extent of it. You have defined the clean area that's not being impacted by the plume, and that's where you're going to place your sentinel wells. But you want to know, is it increasing? Is the plume increasing in size? Is it decreasing? Stable? Does it change direction with time? And does that mean that you've got to reevaluate where your sentinel wells are? Are they appropriately placed for additional sampling, include the analytes that are part of the wrap? And I want to get into that in a second, too. Let me just say that analytes are subject to change. Just because you have degradation of, let us say, TCE, doesn't mean you're home free. What about the daughter products? And what consequences do they have? And we'll talk about that later. 8 quarters of non-increasing concentration will get you to where you need to be in terms of approval for MNA. But plume behavior can only be evaluated after you've applied some type of active remediation to the contamination that's impacting your site. So again, you can do graphical analysis by simply plotting out the plume in very detailed. And keep doing that over sequence of times, and you can actually use that as an argument. It is shrinking, it's stable or it's expanding. And you can do that for very careful designation of boundaries. So it has to be very precise, which means a lot of data. Next, please. Statistical analysis. These are the ones that are identified and discussed, by the way. If you didn't do a good job in statistics, this is the golden book of what you should have known when you took the course. The regression analysis is very good about fitting data along the presumed media with time and see if there's any difference with the regression analysis. And your goal is to get one, and the more that you approximate one, the better off you're going to be. Mann-Kendall takes a look at data, sampling data that based on Whitney and Mann-Kendall are very similar. And basically, one looks at trends at an area, a certain area, and the other looks at specific sampling points, whether it increased and decreased with time. Send test. I never used the send test. They say that it's good for outliers, missing data, and non-detects. I don't know. I'll be perfectly honest with you. I've never used it. I'm not that familiar with it. But apparently, it's got some real good features that you might want to take a look at. And most of this, you can get packaged programs where all you have to do is throw in the numbers, which makes me feel a lot easier when I start going into my statistical approaches. Mass flux is an interesting one. Mass flux is where you have a cross-section of area which encompasses the whole plume, a cross-section of the entire plume, and calculate the contaminant transport through that boundary, through that perpendicular boundary to the plume. And you calculate the mass flux, and if you see it's decreasing, that's a good sign that monitoring natural attenuation is appropriate. I've never used that one either. Next, please. Okay. These are considered secondary lines of evidence, which you're going to have two different types of secondary lines of evidence, one for organic compounds and one for inorganic compounds. Now, in most cases, when you're dealing with organic compounds in groundwater, because the oxidation redox potential is so low, it's probably in the zone of anaerobiosis, anaerobic degradation, all right? So in order to do that, in order to have a breakdown product, we have TCE, we have PCE, we want to degrade it to TCE. I got to come back to that example because it's really an important example. You're going to have to have one, the PCE is going to have to be oxidized. It's going to have to give up electron acceptors, but you need a compound that will accept those electrons. And they're called terminal electron acceptors. And when you see these terminal electron acceptors, such as nitrate converting to ammonia, sulfate converting to hydrogen sulfate, the generation of methane, the development of ferric iron to ferrous iron, that's an indication that you have degradation ongoing. And it's a very strong tool. Now, let's take a look at PCE to TCE to DCE, to vinyl chloride. Just because you have degradation doesn't mean that your compounds are less toxic or less important. For example, when you get TCE, well, PCE gets degraded, can get degraded anaerobically to TCE, and TCE can get degraded to 1,2-DCE. 1,2-DCE, not 1,1-DCE, but 1,2-DCE, right? So when that happens, what's the toxic properties of DCE? They're just almost just as bad, if not as bad, as the parent compounds. So you got to be looking for them too, because they have the same impact as the parent compound. So just because you have degradation doesn't mean it's totally a good thing. It's definitely a good thing, but you got to watch out you got to be concerned about the daughter products as well. Next, please. Secondary evidence for non-organics. This pertains to metals and radionuclides. These are not generally destroyed. Let me catch up here with my notes. Sorry about that. Got it. Okay, I'm here. These are generally not destroyed. Sequestration is generally the answer to this. Let me back up before I give you an example. Results in immobilization. It results in immobilization. What that means, the partition in the groundwater is strong, I'm sorry, in soil is stronger than that of groundwater. Note that under various conditions, if you have sequestration of metals, based on the conditions in the microenvironments, that can change. And you get a reversal where it's no longer sequestered, but can become mobile. And you got to be aware of that. So you need to understand the geochemistry on average, knowing that deviations will occur. So we had a case where it was a marine terminal for petroleum on a waterfront. Bayonne. When they built these huge tanks way back when, they didn't put bottoms in the tanks. What they relied upon was saturation of the soil that essentially became impassable for the petroleum product itself. And petroleum material was dirt cheap at that time. I remember as a kid paying 31 cents a gallon. That shows you how old I am for gasoline. So this is exactly the case in the site that we were working. The tanks did not have bottoms. So now on this site, we have in the soil, we had all these little ganglion of soil particles coated with petroleum product. And we went to the department and said, we can't get all this stuff. And is that residual product? Sure, sounds like it's residual product, doesn't it? And what does the law say for removal of free and residual product? So what we said is, look, our groundwater data shows that this is not getting out. It's not getting into the groundwater. And the groundwater is not impacting the adjacent surface water. How did we know that? We had to collect samples. And by the way, in this particular case, if you collect, I used to say sediment samples are really good. It's a historical indicator. Boy, if I had looked at sediment samples at that point, I probably would have found it because historically it would have been discharged before we reached that point where just the ganglion that were existing. So we took water samples, surface water samples, groundwater samples adjacent to the site, and we showed over 8 quarters, it was fine. Now, obviously, this was a tidal influence. It was being flushed out twice a day and all that stuff. However, we got the ability to say no remediation of that material is necessary. It took a long time to get there. We had a Fortune 500 client who had a lot of money and wanted to make sure that we didn't have to go into the river. And that was a big deal. But on a basis of objective information, you could say that those ganglion were so tied up, so sequestered, that if they moved them, they would move only so slowly, and it was not going to impact. And we had some continuing monitoring requirements. I'm going to get the isotopic analysis in a second. Next, please, Phil. Advice. The Interstate Technology and Regulatory Council is replete with great information. Example, they have a really good one on monitoring natural attenuation. They have a great one for conceptual site modeling. If you really, everybody should have that on their bookshelf. It is a great document. It is a great document as to how to really put together a compelling conceptual site model and what you should be aware of. Also, US EPA guidance has a good one on M&A. And many states have some really good information. Michigan's a decent one. Wisconsin's a very good one. Wisconsin is extremely good in terms of their information and how they approach contamination. So also consult the appendices for details and many of the techniques that we talked about. Look, if you're just reading the narrative, you're doing not even a half a good job. You're doing maybe a third of what you should be doing. Next, please. Okay, now we're into tertiary lines of evidence. Isotopic analysis, did I? No, I get to it. Okay. There's very sophisticated microbiological techniques that you can use. Now, why are you doing that? Because you want to try to identify daughter products, for example, or you want to identify compounds that aren't yours, that are impacting your plume. This is very sophisticated stuff. I have not seen it used widely. I've not even seen it used actually not widely. But we do have, there are ways to do this. And this will be your ability to differentiate, let's say TCE, and you're looking at the microbes that are degrading TCE, and you're looking at whether or not they're similar at one point versus another point. And you could be able to differentiate TCE based on the microbes that are doing the degradation. Next, please. Okay. Isotopic analysis. They call this tertiary evidence. Boy, we didn't put it in the back of the bus. We brought it up front. And we're looking at a landfill. And we're looking at a landfill that was developed in the wetlands. And we're looking at a county that purchased the landfill so as not to, development would not happen so as to interfere next to the county airport. They wanted to preserve it as open space, which they did. But somebody had to close the landfill. The county never operated it as a landfill. They just inherited it. They got hooked with closing the landfill. So now we go through the process of closing the landfill, doing what we should do. Every good landfill deserves a good treatment, a good closure plan, and that was done. But the department came back and said, "Look, you've got all this ammonia, you've got all this arsenic at the landfill proper in your leachate." Right, you're absolutely right. We do. And we're going to take care of it. And we're going to control it, and we're going to treat it, and we're going to cut it off and contain it, and we're going to do all the good. Yeah, but take a look down gradient. Look at all the ammonia that's down gradient. Look at all the arsenic that's down gradient. That's yours, baby. And we said, no. This landfill was built in a wetlands. The area adjacent to us is a wetlands. The area significantly downgraded was a wetlands. What do? Wetlands are anaerobic digesters. They produce all the things that would be happening in the anaerobic portion of the landfill. So we had compounds, similar compounds, downgrading that weren't ours. Arsenic, ammonia, and that was a year and a half argument. So what we did is we did isotopic analysis of the ammonia down gradient and the ammonia that's at our place. We did isotopic analysis on arsenic down gradient and ours, and we differentiated them. And it took us a year to convince DEP that that was legitimate. Even though isotopic analysis is examined in this document, DEP, quite frankly, I'm being observational, I'm not being judgmental, didn't understand it to the degree they needed to understand. They got there eventually. They got there. And we're thankful that they did. And guess what? We got a monitored natural attenuation for our problem. M&A as part of the response action outcome. Now, we have some other things to take care of and clean up. We have an unidentified source of other compounds that we need to take a look at, PNA particularly. So at any rate, it's not for the faint of heart. And it's isotopic analysis ain't cheap either. And not every lab can do it, I'll tell you that right now. Next, please, Phil. Okay. Again, I said this before, beware. Some of the breakdown products are more or equal have equal toxicity than the parents. And they can behave differently than the parent. PCE, TCE, DCE, vinyl chloride, ethene, does it ever get to ethene? I don't know if it gets, most cases it gets to ethene. But having said that, those products are as important as the parent compounds. So even though you're demonstrating breakdown, I would be very surprised if DEP isn't going to tell you to monitor for the daughter products as well, as you should. And that should be your proposal, not theirs. Okay. How long are we on time? 10 more minutes? We're good. I think. Yeah, we're going to be right on time.
You're doing good, George. I know one thing, and I if you'll touch upon, again, this is a guidance document. Okay. So we can deviate from guidance. But you also talked about multiple documents from other states and relying on other resources and, whether it be technical papers or, regulatory papers. If you touch a little bit upon an LSRP's independent professional judgment and we bring all that together when we make our arguments about M&A, because that's been the biggest thing that's been questioned over time.
Yeah, I mean, clearly, the regulations and the law invites you to use the expertise of other states or other agencies or other sources of information. It absolutely does invite you to do that. And that becomes a very compelling feature for saying, we're doing to do X. X is a little bit of an outlier when it comes to New Jersey, but look what Wisconsin did. Look what Massachusetts did. Look what EPA did. Okay, that's a good one. That's a really good one. We had a situation where we were looking for compliance averaging on a particular site that was next to a water body that had PCBs in it. And what we did, well, actually, that's not the case. This is a different case where we had another petroleum terminal. And what we did is we tried compliance averaging, but we found out that the EPA at the Housatonic River used a model called the 4DIM model for compliance average, no, to determine cleanup, when cleanup was done. And boom, the bells went off. We could use that because EPA was using that to say remediation complete. Doesn't get any better than that. So we used the 4DIM model on our site, and we showed that that use of compliance averaging showed that we met standards. And DEP took, I want to say, about 8 months. They actually went to the people who created the model and queried them about it. God bless them. They did their job. They did a good job. This was very novel. This was out there. But if you can go and use as a reference, if you will, EPA did this. State of Wisconsin does this. Pennsylvania does this. New York does this, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Now, not all of them are going to be as stringent or as important as EEPs would like. But having said that, in your use of independent professional judgment, you are capable of putting forth an argument that relies upon the experience of other legitimate agencies or institutions that you can use to defend what you want to do, even if it's a variance that you're getting or an alternative difference, a variance from regulation or an alternative to guidance. Guidance is not dictum. When I was on the stakeholder group from the get-go, I was a strong proponent for guidance. Not to say how you're going to do it, but what's the end goal? What's the end goal that you're looking for by this particular strategy? All right. And if I can figure out how to get there with a different strategy, I should be able to say that my professional judgment is a deviation from guidance and it's appropriate. I can do the same thing for a variance, but variance you've got to do very carefully. It's a variation from a regulation, but you can do it, but document, justify it, write a paper. Essentially, you've got to write a paper and justify why you're using it and why it's applicable. But you can do it. And that's why you're a professional, because the expanse of your knowledge keeps on growing. And you're going to use it accordingly. I'm going to sneeze. I have my fall allergies. I'm going to sneeze. I get so excited about that, Phil. Thank you for asking that. Does that help, Phil?
That definitely helps. I want to make sure that people understand that.
Okay, good. Thanks, Phil.
Yep. You're about, we got 7 more minutes. If there's any questions, raise your hand and or put them in the chat. We'll make sure we get them there.
Yeah, let's finish up. I think I only have 3 more slides. Yeah, 4. Let's go to the next one, Phil. I'll go for it quickly. Okay, so I changed this. This is Jules, I forgot to change this one. It's really modes involved. What modes are involved? You're looking for biodegradation. You're looking for dispersion. You're looking for dilution. You're looking for sorption. You're looking for volatilization. You're looking for stabilization. You're looking for destruction. You're looking for transformation. These are things that you're looking for in order to justify monitoring natural attenuation. It's being degraded. It's being dispersed. It's being diluted. It's being sorbed. It's breaking down. We're getting volatile products. It's stabilized. It ain't going anywhere. Et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So these are the end games that you're looking for. These are the modes, if you will, that you can use to justify MNA. Next, please, Phil. Disciplines involved. This is just a short list. Chemistry, biochemistry, physical chemistry, microbiology, hydrogeology, aquifer characteristics of hydrogeology, geology, physics, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Like I said, when I was being more comprehensive, I stopped the 14 disciplines that impact the role of the LSRP. Next, please, Phil. My God, we're going to be right on time. My reputation is ruined. Okay. So hope for good news, but concentrations of COCs increase. The plume expands. Receptors are imperiled as sentinel wells are impacted. You've identified free product. You have other sources that you don't know about that are impacting with different chemicals and they change with time. The contamination rebounds. That's a biggie. Back rebounding, or whatever it's called, occurs a lot with the chlorinated solvents, because you don't get them all, and then when the concentrations change, they have a greater ability to mobilize alpha soil particles, and away they go. Change in land use, residential developments, schools, childcare facilities. The contamination doesn't conform to the predicted model that you used, or COCs are identified. These are all monkey wrenches that you don't want to find. Next, please, Phil. But, and this is my last slide, believe it or not. M&A is a powerful tool, but the requirements are demanding. It's not for the faint of heart. And you may need, I will guarantee you, you will need a bench, a good bench of team players. M&A is part of a, can be part of an RAO and will require a wrap, but you're also going to be exposed to biennial cert, as well as all the fees, the annual remediation fee, the financial assurance. And the financial assurance, as you know, is fluid. You can either increase it or decrease it based on justification. For groundwater, if you don't have a real good predictor in terms of longevity, it's going to be by default 30 years. Good luck. DEP will have multiple opportunities to challenge you. And don't take it personally, like Jorge Berkowitz does. You know, they're doing their job. They're doing their job. And they're trying to, and I found them to be reasonably cooperative in being objective. And I misspelled multiple, darn it. M&A and TI are probably two of the more demanding options that to prove to DEP. And finally, and I'll leave it here, best of luck. Make sure your bench is ready, and they before the technical consult, make sure they have a steak breakfast, and have fun. I hate to say this, don't have fun. Realize that the DEP is not your enemy. They're just trying to do their job, and sometimes they're not as well equipped as you are for a particular issue. And many of them have multiple items across their desk, multiple complex items in some cases, depending upon what group you're working with. And for them to expect more than you expect of yourself is not fair. So don't expect them to be Renaissance technicians, if you will, who know everything and all things, as you may not. Thank you. Thank you for listening.
Well, don't leave yet. So a question. So you're in the process right now of doing an M&A proposal, and you know that on the brink of new groundwater quality standards come January.
Mm-hmm.
You've already gotten your seven, maybe you're finishing your eighth round of samples. Any thoughts, any, I mean, you're going to get this, you're hoping to get it in by the end of the year.
Yeah, you've got to have, if you have a reproved remedial action work plan, and generally that's going to be the test. If you have an approved remedial action work plan, and generally what you're talking about is leaving material high, that's a lower, that's higher than the new standard, but less than an order of magnitude, greater than the new standard, you're probably going to win. But you got to get some approval first. If you don't get some approval from DEP first, you're going to be in trouble. Good.
Your statement is then be concerned if it's an order of magnitude changed. Justify it if you have some kind of approved document and you can get the application in as soon as possible.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Or have a technical consult. You know, that's the other thing. Say, this is our predicament. This is what we heard from Berkowitz. Do you agree?
Well, I would never name Berkowitz.
Say, no,
I would never
don't
name
use
Berkowitz.
My words. Don't use my name. Don't use my name. But no, I mean, you know, Irene Krop was really good at making sure that you didn't go backwards in these cleanups. And that's why you have this order of magnitude determination. And that's applicable also for TI and so forth and so on.
It looks like the big order of magnitude change is vinyl chloride. For any of us who are doing remediation of chlorinated solvents, that's now going to be a huge, that's a game changer. But benzene is going down for petroleum sites, but it's not an order of magnitude change. So, you know, it's something, but again, I mean, many of these sites, we already have, you know, seven rounds of data and now we're going for the eighth, and you may not get your remedial action permit in by, you know, January.
If they come out in January.
There is a, again, there's 6-month phase-in period. We're waiting to get confirmation on that.
Right.
That's a big key.
Right. And my presumption is, Phil, did they have a robust stakeholder process?
Remember, this is not, groundwater quality standards does not come from the site remediation program. That comes
doesn't matter.
From,
I'm talking DEP. Yeah.
I don't know. I can't answer that question.
Yeah. I mean, look, they're a state agency, and what they do is really, in terms of public input, is very important. And if they didn't have a stakeholder, and this becomes regulation, they have to have stakeholder process.
They had some kind of stakeholder process. Yeah. I don't know the
and the hearings are pro forma. I mean, the hearings don't change anything. Once they're published, they're going to go with it.
Okay, I have 9:02. So we are right on schedule. Any other questions or comments? Otherwise, we will conclude. This will be posted on the seepsnj.com website for perpetuity. And you can share it once it goes up there, and your colleagues can do it too. George, thank you very much for a very detailed presentation on M&A. I think the in-depth aspect of it will help with those people who are doing M&A proposals with remedial action permit applications. Don't forget also, we have upcoming classes. Check seepsnj.com for more hot topics. I know we have one coming up in the next few weeks, which will be on how to work as an LSRP with your clients and their understandings and the PRCRs as to the work that you are performing. So, yeah, George, thanks for your time and all your hard work.
No, thank you, folks. Thank you for the attendance, and I hope it meant something to you. I have fun doing these things. And by the way, it's like teaching something is learning it for a second time, or maybe the first time, as the case may be. So thank you for the opportunity to relearn.